I'm afraid we need to start with the news, as usual. The truck driver in Nice who killed more than 80 people is claimed by ISIS as a soldier in their war against the West. There is no indication that he is allied with them. In fact, there is no indication he's a practicing Muslim. He didn't pray, he didn't fast. In fact, he ate pork. He drank a lot, he smoked pot. He had a nervous breakdown in 2004. He'd just been fired from his job and gotten his second divorce. He was known for domestic abuse, had a record for assault. His father said he would become angry and shouted, adding he would break anything he saw in front of him. So the idea this is a terrorist attack from the Muslims is false. It is a fabrication that will be used by ISIS and by those in American and French politics who want to govern by creating fear. From the New Yorker, for the ISIS leadership, the act of killing is only one part of the strategy. More important is the reaction that follows. The expense of sending soldiers to the streets, the alienation of Muslims in the West by incendiary right-wing politicians, the elimination of what ISIS calls the gray zone. Yes, it's horrible, but it is a mistake to tar all Muslims with the same brush and to overreact. We have to maintain a conscious discernment and not fly off the handle, like some public figures running around saying we have to test the Muslims and maybe deport them all too. We do not want to return to the 1940s, where most of the Japanese on the West Coast lost their homes, their jobs, their businesses, their footholds in America, because they were all tarred with the same brush as the Japanese Air Force that bombed Pearl Harbor. There was an all-Japanese American battalion in Europe that fought with great bravery. They felt they had to prove themselves. Interning the Japanese population was a mistake. And we also have the shame in our nation's history of religious persecution, chasing a smallish group of believers in a form of Christianity that the locals didn't like. Chased out of New York to Ohio, then to Illinois, then to Missouri, and finally kicked out of the country into Mexico. We killed thousands of them on the way. We are, of course, talking about the Mormons. Remember, in 1838, Utah was still part of Mexico. They were safe in Mexico. They were not safe in the United States. And needless to say, we've already done it to the Native Americans big time. Cut them down because they're not like us. So back to the truck. This guy, described by those who know him as an oddball with a temper, went nuts. We can compare him to the killer in Orlando who had significant mental illness and claimed ISIS as inspiration. Also, Timothy McVeigh in our own country, the not very smart fellow who blew up the federal building in Oklahoma City. There's a powerful resistance to the idea that McVeigh was listening to extremist right-wing talk radio when he got where he got most of his ideas. But there it was, in the airwaves. Allow me to paraphrase. You people are tired of the government taking over. Black helicopters, the ATF coming for your guns. I heard it on the radio, and those who are easily manipulated became true believers. The radio guy is saying, there's going to be an explosion out there. And Timothy McVeigh driving around in his pickup saying, that's me he's talking about. 168 died. He was no Muslim. Blowing up federal buildings or mowing down men, women, and children who were out to see fireworks, mental illness can be very narcissistic. They don't even know anyone else exists. I'm sorry so many people will fall for the panic mongers. I'm sorry scaring the easily led is so profitable. It makes a great business model, and it makes a few people very rich. But we have to keep our heads. We have to talk down the fear mongers. Now let's look at the text for today. Amos, the Psalms, and Luke. Amos is famous. Amos is famous. He's famous for chapter 5, verse 24. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Dr. King quoted this a lot. Amos is about justice being done in this world, not saved up for the afterlife. In today's verses, Amos is calling out the rich and their abuse of the poor. He is warning them of great reversals to come. Celebrations will be mourning. Songs turn into lamentations. The people will put on the colors of the mourner and tear their hair out. The hard words of God's disappointment ring out. I will make it like the mourning for an only child, and the end of it like a bitter day. Verse 4, hear this, you that trample on the needy, and bring ruin to the poor of the land, saying, we will make the ephah small and the shekel great. Let's analyze that. The ephah is a unit of dry measure of grain, about the size of a bushel. So, make the ephah small means the oppressors will short the buyers in what they are selling. And make the shekel great means they will overcharge for the grain because the poor have to eat. And those who practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat. Okay, buying the poor for silver means buying them cheap. They are not even as valuable as gold. We can buy and sell them easily. They are worthless human beings, subhuman, the other. And that means we are worthy because we are rich, not because we're good. The poorer they are, the more we can cheat them. People are barely worth the price of a pair of sandals. Why? Because they are needy. Selling the sweepings of the floor means they disobey the traditional instructions that God has given to sustain the poor. Leave some grain in the fields around the edges for the poor people to glean. Leave the sweepings on the threshing floor for them as well, for them to gather. The rich can take even what little is left to the poor, not because they need it, but because starving them increases their power over the poor. It lowers their prices. The less they have, the cheaper it is to enslave them. And somehow this makes the wealthy feel good about themselves. We see that in our own times. The effort to keep wages low means people who have a job are scared to speak up against abuse because they might get fired. They can't save up what we used to call quitting money, which was enough to walk off the job if your boss treated you badly, and enough to tide you over while you looked for another job. The cops in Dallas who got shot last week don't even make $15 an hour. A raise of the minimum wage to $15 an hour would mean the Dallas police would get a raise. And as we know from our work with families moving forward, the market rate for housing is up here, and the market rate for labor is down here. The market will not solve this problem. And now we can see how the system keeps poor people poor. And what does God say about that? Verse 7, the Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. The Psalms strikes the same chord of condemnation. Verse 3, you love evil more than good, and lying more than speaking the truth. Selah. Pause and think. You love all words that devour, O deceitful tongue. But God will break you down forever. He will snatch and tear you from your tent. He will uproot you from the land of the living. The righteous will see and fear, and I will laugh at the evildoer, saying, verse 7, See the one who would not take refuge in God, but trusted in abundant riches and sought refuge in wealth. Let's hear that again and think about the United States. See the one who would not take refuge in God, but trusted in abundant riches and sought refuge in wealth. We are being warned by God that we face a reckoning if we abuse the poor instead of supporting them. If the wealthy treated the poor fairly, paid them fairly, did not cheat them in the marketplace, that would be a wealthy person who has sought the refuge of God. Make no mistake, there is a role for the wealthy in God's mercy. But that's not what usually happens. If we treat them with a created scarcity instead of generosity in abundance, God will remember. The only thing wrong with poor people is that they don't have any money. There have been several studies that also show that poor people are more generous than the rich people. Anecdotal testimony by people who are begging at street corners in the U.S. say, "It's the poor guys in beat-up cars and loud mufflers who give me $1 or $5. It's the rich people in their Mercedes that lock their doors and pretend like I'm not there." In America for the past 40 years, poor people are treated like God is punishing them because they are evil. And if you are rich, God is blessing you because you are good. That's called the prosperity gospel, and it is anathema to the teachings of Jesus. It is the object of God's disfavor. Jesus did not say, "Blessed are the poor, because we will kick them to the curb and let them starve." And this brings to mind a great quote from Pope Francis. "We pray for the hungry, then we feed them." That's how prayer works. That's what we do here. We pray for the homeless, then we get them into clean beds and a warm room and help them find a home, and we also lobby the community to build them affordable housing. There's nothing wrong with people who are homeless. They just don't have a place to live. Now let's look at the story from Luke. Jesus is coming through town, itinerant. He's staying in a house. Let's look at this particular time and place. Women ran the house because if they were pregnant or had kids, they were the ones who stayed home with them. Men went out into the world to secure a living by farming or herding or hiring themselves out. In the time of Jesus, and even now in many Orthodox communities, men learned the Torah and the Talmud, and women did what they were told. Women cleaned up the house and prepared the food in hospitality. Men sat in the parlor talking about what is important. I'm sure women participated here and there, but what I'm describing is the social ordering of roles. Martha had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. What? Here's one of several revolutions of Jesus, that women were worth teaching, that they were equal to men. Paul drew from stories like this when he said, "In Christ, there is no Jew nor Greek, no rich nor poor, no male nor female." Paul nails three revolutions in that statement. Jews felt superior to Greeks, and vice versa. The rich, then and now, feel superior to the poor. And men, then and now, feel superior to women. So Jesus is shattering one of those societal rules. He is teaching a woman as if she were a man, as if she were a man's equal. He is creating justice by creating equality. Remember, justice does not exist in nature. We have to create it ourselves, each of us. Justice is rendered onto people's bodies. So is injustice. People who believe that Christianity is about the afterlife only, the pie in the sky, don't read the Bible enough. It's right there in front of us. Jesus is creating justice by teaching a woman. In the same way that God calls us to serve the least of these by giving the poor a fair shake and a chance to eat. Jesus is giving the lowest of the low, a woman, a chance to learn and grow intellectually and spiritually. Martha is irritated. She doesn't care about Mary being taught. She cares about being stuck with all the work. For her, that's the greater injustice, being left with all the cooking and cleaning. Who does Mary think she is? One of the guys? Isn't she getting a little hoity-toity? Martha doesn't even address Mary. She complains to Jesus, the man who can tell Mary what to do. He is automatically standing in the house. He has automatic standing in the house to tell women of their proper roles. Martha can't even do that. Verse 40. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. Aren't we all? There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better path, which will not be taken away from her. Whatever she has learned, it will not fade away." This is a famous story. We are too busy to sit and learn. We are too swept up in our sweeping to pause, to be quiet, and listen for the voice of God. Too busy to hear what Jesus has to teach us. Too much in the present, too much into presentism, to stop and take a moment with what is eternal. We could sort out our time a lot better if some of it was dedicated to learning wisdom and truth, dedicated to reminding ourselves of giving instead of just getting. Giving time, talent, and a little treasure to the relief of the poor instead of squeezing them for all they have. Dedicated to silence, to quiet, to meditation, to listening for the voice of God. Giving of ourselves instead of withholding because we are afraid. We must follow this example of another Mary. We must choose the better part, that which cannot be taken away. Let us pray. Dear God, our Creator, please help us stay on the path of justice and mercy. Help us to listen with discernment instead of running on ahead in our brains with what we're going to say next. Bless us with 20 minutes a day of quiet, of reflection, of listening. All this we ask in your name. Amen.